Initially, I would like just to read 10 reflections that constitute our idea about architecture. So, of course, we will show you later just many works, but I think that it's very important to make some statements, especially nowadays, speaking about what we think about architecture. One of the problems of architecture of nowadays is we are losing just the ideology. We are losing the ideas that are behind the works. So I think that we have to reinforce. In our times, where the image is much more important than the contents, I think that we should to make an effort in order to be very clear what we think about architecture, what we hope about architecture, how we define our architecture. So I think that is especially important. Nowadays, we live in unbelievable amount of images, of appearance, but the most important is precisely how we face architecture in order to serve the society. So let me to read the letter when I was teaching recently in the School of Architecture of Cornell University in the United States, the dean asked to me about writing a letter to the students. Just precisely, initially, just in order that the students could know exactly which were my ideas about architecture. So let me to read briefly just this letter. It will take just 10 minutes. I know that is perhaps a little tedious, but I think that is important in order to understand all the project that after this reading, I will show to you. So in this world, dear students, I wrote them, in this world we live in mainly one of the lack of hope and aspiration, where one society where only market laws are the ultimate reference, where we communicate continuously but don't stop to think about the times we want to create. Is everything just temporary and superficial? Do commitment exist at all? Have we ideology? Are we committed with something? Is architecture a reflection, unfortunately, of these times? Are we not creating a kind of architecture where seeming is much more important than being? In a society that heralds the triumph of the market as a consequence of the end of thoughts and the end of ideologies, the past years have seen develop of an excessive worship in the object. So everyone was concerned about the object in architecture, but not about the contents. An object that is a laboratory object, autistic, more concerned about his look and capacity to make an impact than about its content. All the architects were concerned about how to make the most, strange building. So we should not forget that architecture is related to a society and a time. This architecture should respond to the context and places, to cultures and realities that are precisely what give it content. Without the history, without the context, there is not content for making architecture. We must make it our priority to go beyond superficial calligraphies and bring back to our practice the idea of architectural form as something that is subject to contents and answers. I believe that architecture must have an ethical dimension, and that this ethical dimension should constantly govern our work. As architects, we should reflect on what we do and what we serve. Architecture and the practice thereof is service. But service is not servility, it's not the same. In other words, I do not believe in architecture as a mere reflection of the society it serves. What has society asked for us of us so far? What society claimed for the architect? Production or spectacle? My idea of service has more to do with transgression, giving more than what society asks to us. For this to happen, as I was saying at the start, we have to go beyond an exclusively object-oriented approach to architecture and bring back the desire to contribute thoughts and ideas of the kind that give substance and values to our work. Architecture should redefine interdisciplinary. The connection of architecture to other disciplines and realities is fat, and has been through the history the same. As a social discipline and a service-oriented one, architecture requires intellectual curiosity and a change. Curiosity, the compulsion to ask questions, is a prerequisite to making architecture. The student should be continuously asking themselves, wondering about what architecture means. Yet in our times, perhaps as a consequence of the erosion of principles, interdisciplinary has been seen as a dissolution or near disappearance of the architecture discipline. So many times, architecture, we have used the interdisciplinary relationship as an excuse for not doing architecture and for giving the power of the architecture to other roles in the society. I am, of course, interested in interdisciplinarity connection that contribute to improving the architectural response. Consideration regarding program, relation to plates, space, the process by which the project is materialized, and so on, all this remains the direct object of our work. So in other words, I'm interested in interdisciplinary relationship, but precisely for improving our architecture, for improving our disciplines, but not for renouncing to do architecture. Many architects nowadays has make a definition in the sense that architecture is finished. So I don't believe it. Architecture is a fantastic and very powerful social discipline that obviously requires just the connection with other disciplines, but without using this connection as an excuse for renouncing for doing it. In the intellectual exercise of architecture, the past years have seen an overuse of the term speculation. I prefer to speak about investigation. Usually, after the terms of speculation, is just a kind of word that is much more concerned about the calligraphy, about how the appearance of the buildings, about how to look for the kind of language that is going to be repeated independently of the site, independently of the time, independently of the context, that the real investigation. So students must understand that they have a right to make mistakes. You have the right to make mistakes. That they should want to go further and take risks, but that these risks must be enlightened, the fruit of earning knowledge, not of reducing our profession to mere obsession with novelty. I'm not particularly interested in looking for a kind of identity. I prefer to use the idea of unity. Identity is usually synonymous to a set image of one's own, a stylistic code to be repeated independently of the place or the problem at hand. I would rather speak of a conceptual unit in the sense of something that, while repeating the concern and basis that constitute one's particular way of going about things, nevertheless defines a world mechanism that is capable of understanding the particularities of the place or problem at hand. I believe in looking for beauty in architecture, but I don't think of this beauty only in sensory terms, which is very important, obviously. I see it has been linked to contents, and even further, to an ethical dimension of architecture. Reflecting on architecture's responsibility towards its surroundings and specifically towards the environment, I have always believed that there should be an adequate relationship between the resources that we use for doing architecture in a project and the objectives, the targets achieved. This is an idea that brings me closer to my idea of beauty. More responsibility is the answer to the question of how to serve a society that cannot afford to waste resources. And more responsibility is synonymous to more intelligent architecture. Against the ideas that give importance to extraordinary technical means, to ever more sophisticated technology, or even worse, to the technologies that develop the kind of environmental style, I simply say more architecture, more intelligence, more knowledge. Because of his capacity to establish connection between different architecture, I am much more interested, and particularly interested, and give priority in my work to the public space. The connections that are made with an attitude of consideration and high regard for public space are always more important than the object itself. This relationship is precisely the relationship which gives architecture a civic dimension and a capacity to build cities of true value. In my architecture, I'm particularly interested with three concepts. The first one is the relationship with the site. The second one is how to shape, how to organize the space. The third one, absolutely, is the commitment with the materialization, how we materialize the project. These three concepts, I believe, that are particularly basic in the architecture, and we never should forget it. I would like to think that I have all the time for architecture, for doing architecture, to work on it and time to enjoy it, but unfortunately I have not it. This is the most important material for doing architecture. Someone told that the most important material is the light. It's true, the light is very important for doing architecture, but nowadays much more important is precisely the time. The market is absolutely obsessed with the idea that the people, not only in architecture, don't have time. Because if you don't have time, you have no time for thinking. You have no time for revealing. You have no time for being critic. Then means that at the end, the market is the most powerful. So the time is precisely what we should continuously claim for. Time is the most important material in architecture, the most important material for thinking, building, and also enjoying it. I still don't know of any good building that doesn't improve with time. And yet I know of many buildings, apparently very successful ones, that do not withstand the passage of time. And I mean this not only in a constructional sense, but also in an ideological and therefore architectural ones as well. I finish this writing with this last paragraph. Dear students, we are fortunate to be in a rich and wonderful discipline. Never before have there been so many prospects for architecture. We have certainly never had such good and well-trained young architects. So be demanding and selective. Be critic. Don't reduce architecture to mere graphic experimentation. Architecture is something much deeper, something much more critic. You can use architecture for revealing, for providing society with something better. Our profession requires research, rigor, risk-taking, and hope. Be optimistic. It is possible to work in architecture intensively. Doesn't matter how little work are for doing architecture. Don't renounce to try to do it. Doesn't matter where you are going to work, which is going to be your position. Always it is possible to defend architecture. Always it is possible to be optimist with architecture. We have the most optimist discipline. You are in a position of responsibility and will encounter difficult moments, undoubtedly, especially when you try to reveal against and try to go beyond the obvious or the easy way. Go ahead and do so. You will enjoy architecture. So is the idea that we have about basically trying is going to be a little the statement that I will develop with my students next semester here. And we will use the project that we are going to develop in order to improve, to intensify, to underline these ideas. Now, I'm going to show you some project that I imagine this is what you are expecting. It's a soccer stadium that we finished some years ago. The first two projects are going to be related with sport facilities. The first one will be just this soccer stadium. The second one, a covered swimming pool for a university. So I'm not going to describe the project. It's something stupid. I'm going to try to express the main concept that are behind the each approach. So Palencia is an important, fantastic. Okay. This one? Okay. Palencia is a very historical city in the middle of Spain. It's quite close of Madrid, And this and the bueno, okay. This is the downtown of the city, so you can see how this soccer stadium, or the site where the soccer stadium was going to be built, is very close to the downtown. So it is not necessary to take the car for going to the soccer stadium. Usually the soccer stadiums are in the outskirts. Yes, and people take the cars just only one time every 2 weekends. Yes, and Spain time, and so okay. So it was very close. In fact, now, if you were to visit this area, it's completely surrounded with housing. So we knew then in the competition, we knew that this area will be completely full of housing. So when the local council called just to 10 architects in Spain in order to develop this soccer stadium. And it was very funny because the president of the local council, instead just explaining which were the requirements or just which were the wishes just for doing this building, they were complaining continuously because they were telling that this the money that was going to the millions, euro millions, that was going to be spent in this soccer stadium were absolutely necessary for doing just office building, service building for the local council. But as the majority of the people were supporting the idea of making a new soccer stadium that never will be, of course, from an economical point of view, will be profitable. So finally, he has not the political power, or he has not the political, he didn't dare just to do the other building that will be a service. So, and when I return just to Pamplona, I have the idea of making two buildings in one building. I remember that when we returned just a month later for making the presentation of the competition, I didn't explain anything about the stadium. The only thing that I told just to the mayor, okay, you are going to have a soccer stadium and you are going to have an office building, yes, for the city for the same price. Just the 15 millions that you have estimate for the building. So it's very easy. Architecture, we work with program. So it is very easy just to transform. The architecture is something that is magic. We are as magic men. We can use different elements. The reality is fantastic, it's very rich, and you can transform. So, and it's exactly what we did. So we decided then to use the ground floor for, the ground floor has 8,000 square meters, yes, for using this ground floor for the offices of the building of the local council. So it's a guarantee. Then what happened is that the usually this kind of buildings are occupied just only one time every 2 weeks, as you know, probably the soccer supporters know very well. But now it's fantastic because the building is occupied every day and every time. And the citizens just come here just for solving the problems. They have here health assistance, yes, okay, many different activities that were used. So the only thing that we did was just elevate the grass area and just to create in the corners so very huge ramps that allows just the spectators just to arrive to the grass areas. But in fact, what happened is that the old ground floor, of course, we won the competition, not because the project was, we won immediately the competition. But it's something that we can provide. With this kind of ideas is much more important than the formal questions that I will just to explain now. Yeah, I will explain now. Because probably you are, the students are thesis about this, the formalization, or just the materials, or just the stylistic effects. But the most important in this case is a programmatic decision that save the city 15 million euros. It's something that you, with your architectonical intelligence, can do. So this is the difference in between this attitude that I was explaining, calligraphic attitude, or thinking that architecture is only appearance, or yes, architecture means contents. So, okay, this is the organization, it's explained the project. So this is the ground floor, which contains just the offices just for the local council. We define, of course, all the urbanization, but I don't want to explain it. We lead this river, and of course, was very important. This is the ramps that allows us to arrive precisely to the soccer stadium that is here. Is it soccer stadium? Yes, we didn't use very strong technology. I wanted to provide the local council. The soccer stadium. Yes, with this image of low cost, of low technology. In fact, it was very important, as I'm telling to you, this idea that more than a soccer stadium, we were making a building that is going to be enveloped, by other housing buildings. And the idea was to create a quite citizen soccer stadium. So from the programmatic point of view, something that is familiar for the city and is familiar just for the users. So of course, it's very important the material that we used was aluminium sheet perforated that was bent in order to look for this kind of triangle, which means that we don't require a special auxiliary structural system, which means that we are going to save a lot of money. And this is the interior. So when you are walking around the soccer stadium, you have an idea about what is happening outside. And on contrary, during the night, then you have also an idea about what is happening inside. So this is the opening match, Italy against Spain. Don't be happy because Italy lost the match for the 2-0. And of course was that was not an important match. Was only within match in between colleagues, and what is funny is that let me to explain. So I have explained you the most important issue of this building is that we save 15 million. Okay, the day of the opening of this stadium. So pay attention about what the society, the idea that the society, especially the journalists, has about architecture. But it's something that we have created. So the journalists asked to me about what do you think that is the most important of this building. And I was continuously explaining that the architect have make a project that was solving two problems with only one architectonical decision. They were not concerned about it. They not were interested about it. So they asked just only about these very visible light towers. Was their only interest. And I said, but doing this is very easy for an architect. I mean, there are 100 of you could do these light towers. It's something, and for confusing them and for making a lay, and just in order to evaluate how stupid could be the journalist, I make a lay and I say, okay, Palencia is a wonderful site with wonderful Romanesque, and very old, usually from the 11th century, that are these towers are very fat and very low, exactly the contrary that this tower. And I say, no, I have done these light towers as a kind of homage, as a kind of reference to this Romanic towers architecture in Palencia. The next day, no one spoke about that the city has saved 15 million. They spoke about this kind of course, false homage to the Romanic in Palencia. So it's stupid. They need, very simple explanation. That's the problem. For instance, I don't believe that architecture has to be metaphoric. Nowadays, unfortunately, the majority of the project that you appreciate and you consider a lot are explained from a metaphoric point of view. It's a very simplistic attitude. So we have to think a little more. Okay, next, this is the view from the motorway. Everyone was very excited with the project received the European Prize of Sport Activities. I don't know, but no one pay attention about the real reason which explains this project. That is a programmatic point of view. The second one is a project in a university in the northwest of Spain. This is the university is quite complex. I don't going to explain how the university works, but in any case, this is part of the campus. Just in the top of this area, in the highest point of this campus, you can see
part of this campus. Okay, in this point, that is the highest one, we won the competition for making just a swimming pool, covered swimming pool. So this is about 10 meters higher than this other part of the campus. Okay, this is interesting because it's a sport facility, it's a covered swimming pool for the students of the university. And always I have the idea, the most important idea was not thinking about exactly how was going to be the swimming pool. The most important idea was how to use this special point in the campus as a kind of balcony. So as a kind of swimming pool that will be hung on the campus. And then this sport facility will come the best point of view of the campus. So you could be just swimming, but you have an idea about the library, the other students just studying for the exam, while you are just enjoying of the... So what's creating this atmosphere, very exciting, very relaxing, just in the top point of the university. So, but the second question was, of course, to avoid the structure and how to use the light. The light in this, in the Northwest, is very gray, it's very dark. So any gram of light that you can introduce inside the building is absolutely important. So how to use the light and how to use the water, the surface of the water as a kind of mirror, yes, in order to multiply the light was the second point which explained this project. So it's not very, it's very simple. How you can see in the plan, how important are these two parts of balcony. And this is the position of the swimming pool with this huge cantilever expressing formally this idea of projecting just the swimming pool as in a kind of balconies on the campus. We use the same granite that is very common in the historical buildings in this area. This is the access, the ramp that link just the highest point, the top, with the bottom area of the campus. And here you can see these spaces that we use just for using for. And this is the vision, the views that you have just when you are just using the swimming pool. On the this is the library university. This is on the right is the technical buildings. The other one is the literary. And so this idea of how to use the structure in order to look for this water that is this light that here is uniform because precisely is dilute and is reflected with the water surface. Okay, the next two projects that I'm going to show you are quite huge projects. First one. The first one is a project that this was really complicated. It was the result of winning all the projects that I'm going to show you are winning competitions. So no one of them are with private commissions. All of them are competitions. And as you know, in Spain, it was very common, the fantastic competition, yes, until the before the crisis, until 7 years ago. And in 1 month, in 2 months, we passed of being in the heaven to going to be in the hell. It was terrible. In 2 months, the competition disappeared, the project disappeared, the commission disappeared, and the architect disappeared. So, and at the moment, the 80% of the offices are closed in Spain. 80%. So we become in Italian attitude in 2 months, in Italian situation in 2 months. So which has been dramatic. We were not prepared for doing it, but that's a matter. This competition, this matter, we always will have chances for doing architecture. You have to be optimist. Architecture is not a question of size. Now you are going to see enormous buildings. And now I'm making a very small building. Probably there are more architecture in this small building than in the... But it's the same. Anywhere that you are projecting exists architecture. Doesn't matter if it's furniture. So you have to look yourself in any piece of architecture that you want. So this is one of the most important, if not the most important, historical city of Spain, Ávila. Is Patrimonio de la UNESCO, de la Humanidad. So it's a fantastic medieval walls, very well preserved. It's 50 kilometers far from Madrid. In this area, exactly here, this is a photograph that was taken during the 50s, 1950s. In this area, we have to build just a Congress Hall and just an exhibition area. There were just a competition with about 300 entries. And this is the, let me to explain you the kind of city we are speaking about. It's a city of a kind of architectural intensity, but it's not conceptually. So it's not only an urban density that we can read, for instance, in this world. So it's an urban density because the city is completely closed, so you can read exactly. So it's another kind of density that is a physical density that is summarized in these fantastic granite walls. A granite that you can read just in the underground. So the same granite that you can find in the underground that is used for making the walls, for making the bridges, for making the buildings. So this is fantastic. And in this area that nowadays were occupied just by this market for the cows and for horses, and that was going to be demolished, we have to do. The majority of the competition, if not all the competition, were much more concerned about how to do a building, how to do a big object, and a very, very fashionable object in the middle of this area, that assuming the context. This is a historical context. It's not possible just to make a building without taking into account this fantastic wall and how we're going to be the interference from the distance, the view interference in between the building and just the walls. Many of the new housing developments that has been developed here were destroying the views of the walls from the distance. So the heritage, they protect the buildings just in 50 or 80 meters. But it's what is happening in the distance? So it's a disaster. So I decided to use the topography. So my idea was to consider this huge building with 25,000 square meters, that the building was going to house just Congress Hall for 1,500 people, another Congress Hall for 500 people, exhibition areas, a big exhibition areas, how it is possible to fit all of these big volumes just with the walls. So we renounced to make a building itself. Of course, it's a building. But we look for a kind of topography building. We use the topography. We decided to sink in the building, making the most of the topography. And then, so we decided to sink here the building and to modify a little the topography in order to guarantee that the height of the building here never will overpass the limit, the height of the walls. And also, the building could assume a profile very low in this relationship. Of course, we provide the importance to the space that in between the walls and the building. The building is not important in itself. It's much more important what is happening here. And in fact, we define a space for organizing some summer activities that will be very, very, very important. So, This is the result. We use the same granite that was going to be used for the walls. And here you can read how soft is this slope, creating this continuity in between the walls and the building that now is really sunk, and the majority of the program, 80%, is sunk. So this is the organization that is very clear. The access to the building is through this top level. So we use just the slope in order to fit the majority of the audience exactly here. And this is very clear. And we use this perimeter just in order to house many of the servant activities. And we will explain later about this. So this is the square of the access. From here, you can see how low is the building, the height of the building. This is the view from the distance in between the building that now is much more darker just because of the pollution, and how we use exactly the same idea of something very thick, something very volumetric, just trying to look for language quite similar just to the wall. So, but I like this photograph, yes, because you can read the different layers of the history, buildings from different centuries, and all of them are unified, yes, by this granite. But at the same time, you can see how this building that is using the same atemporal language, which is precisely this idea of the thickness, this idea of the volumetric, this idea of compacity, that independently, yes, of the window expression, or yes, on specific elements of the language, at the end what happens is that you are the content of the discourse is quite similar, yes, to the historical. So when we get inside, the building disappears, because really the most important facade of this building is not this one, it's just the walls. So in this way, we create, I like to think that we are creating a new building, which is precisely outside. And the limit of this building is the new construction and the old construction, because many of the activities are developed just here. Yes, reinforcing the importance of this space in between the nature and yes, what is built, we are providing with this connection in between the history and the new. I remember when the king and the queen of Spain were to open in this building, precisely the queen was the sensitivity, yes, to understand this idea that that not doing a building. So this is the access to the auditoriums. You can see part of the auditoriums. This is the entries in the top level. The light is extremely important, because precisely when the building is sunk, we have to use, yes, to manipulate, yes, the roof in order, and the volumes in the roof, in order to guarantee that the light that was coming from the above could get in, yes, to the lowest levels. In fact, we use this kind of glass that is made with a mirror, and this special glass made with mirror with two layers. The first one is just glass, and the second one is a mirror. Then is completely opaque, and then it provides with a kind of very mineral aspect just to the building. But what is the most important is that it reflects the 100% of the light, which means that all the light that is coming from the skylights is arriving just to the lower level. So we have to do exactly a big exhibition area, and an exhibition area that, according with the program, has to work independently, especially because many times the Congress Palace or the auditorium are closed, but there are some exhibitions during the weekend. So this idea of trying to independence a little the programs was very clear in the back of the mind of the people that were promoting this building. And then I like to see this image, you know, this image of the walls that has been created by the man, and just the same granite, the nature that is escaping. So this reference, we try to reproduce just in this tool. We use the same material, this is quite organized, and then this piece assumes a quite organic role, just because it's used just for defining the new slope, the topography slope, that which leads from here just to the river. Also, this provides with the possibility of creating a new access, but also to define, to repeat a little what is happening here in this fight, struggling between the nature and just the artificial construction. So this is completely detached in the first level, but of course is linked in the second level, which provides with a clear relationship between the two parts of the building. We wanted to reproduce in a very simple way this organic expression of the roof, and then we reproduce this just only cutting the roof with this beam each meter, and we use a very extremely thin steel pilasters, which 1 centimeter, that are reinforced with this kind of triangles in order to avoid precisely the deformation, because they are extremely thin. But always is the relationship just with the outside. And this area is very used just for organizing many different activities. The last one was an exhibition of, cars, of Volkswagen, or I don't know. They use a lot this building. Even I have seen just some exhibition of horses inside, that is very, very nice. This second auditorium and Congress Palace is much smaller. If you are bored, please tell me, because I can stop when you want, okay? More than a lecture is a kind of conversation. So for me, this project is particularly important because the first time that I work in the Mediterranean. I'm coming from the north, so I'm coming from a country where the light is very dark. It's very gray. We have not this explosive light. So working in the Mediterranean was for me an inspiration, was my main target. In fact, we knew that this competition was open. This competition, the auditorium is very small, it's 6,000 square meters. That years ago in Spain was a very small building. Now it's unbelievable. Now there are 1,000 of people just fighting for this building. But years ago was completely, was very, but I knew the information about the competition, and immediately I decided to accept it for the two reasons. The first one is because it was my first time for facing the Mediterranean light. As you can see, I'm quite obsessed always with the light in my architecture, of course. For me, it was an important challenge. Second one was because it's so fantastic, the site. So unbelievable the social situation and the geographical situation of this site that was not possible not participating in the competition. And we were so enthusiastic that probably we won for this reason. So this is in Alicante province. Probably you know very well. Alicante province is one of the most important tourist provinces in the Mediterranean, Spain Mediterranean. But what is interesting is that this city, it's a city that is divided in two completely different parts. So this is a part that is on the beach. It's full of very small single houses, just very plain, and just 3 kilometers, because this is not real. So the distance is 3 kilometers farther, and 500 meters higher on a mountain, there are another part of the city. And they have the same mayor, it's the same city, and they have a very strong rivalry. So the people that are living on the sea, that is living in the mountain. But it's fantastic, because I have to work in a space, in the higher space of the city, but just with these two ideas of the territory, the sea and the mountain. What more you can expect for doing architecture? So it's fantastic. In fact, you can see here the site. This is the site. It's in the top of the highest part of the city. And I have these views. The sea from here as a balcony and behind the mountains with the difference of 400 meters. So it was fantastic. And of course, the building has to be open to the sea. But being open to the sea, this orientation means to be meant in this case to be oriented towards the south. And the south is terrible in the Mediterranean because means a lot of heat. Means that you are going to spend a lot of energy for keeping fresh just the building. So the decision was, the only decision was how to make a big balcony open to the sea without the direct entry of the sun. Guaranteeing that we could have just light, but not the sun. In order to guarantee that this poor municipality, that at the same time likes a lot just the concert and the music, is one of the most, this little auditorium has organized unbelievable music performance, but the highest level. So, because they like, and there are a lot of people from Germany, from Great Britain, even from Italy, that lives there. So there are citizens of this. So how to organize this? And then we started to work. I remember with the first sketch, I started about, because from this facade comes all the organization of the building. We have just only an auditorium of 700 people. It's quite humble. Another one is smaller. But in fact, we study continuously this facade, making many different geometries, and just looking for the geometry that could guarantee us, according with the different sun studies during the year, the minimum entry of the direct sun. And this was the result. So, this facade concentrated majority of the programs. The restaurant is here, facade is this one, and with a geometry that I repeat is coming from this very, very accurate study of the sun, and making the most of the topography, we decided just to use this this ground floor or just this intermediate foundation, just for organizing one exhibition area that could be supporting the different Congress activities. But one of the most interesting reflection was again to use this define the shape of the building to use this reference to the mountains. So we decided to use the concrete and this special roof in order to establish a kind of reference, a kind of liaison between the new building and the mountain. The new building could be read as a kind of of course, a balcony looking at the sea, but at the same time as a kind of rock, white rock that could work very well yet reflecting the light. This rock that is precisely finishing the slope of the architecture escape village that is completely white, is not very interesting, that finished precisely in the Hagges point. So I like also to think this building, I told you that it's not very interesting the metaphor. The metaphor is not interesting for doing architecture, for explaining the architecture, but it's very poetic. I mean, the reasons that explain a project should be something different of the metaphor. But the metaphor could be very helpful in order to create this poetic attitude or approach to architecture that I think is interesting. And I like to see this as a kind of rock and at same time as a kind of lighthouse when the building is going to be seen from the distance, from the beach. Because from the beach, with this blue facade that we have used, you can see just the building is a kind of reference. So this is the inside of the building with the light. I don't want to spend more time. You can see this is in the morning. This is the exhibition areas that is very is used a lot, just because this little village has probably they won't have more money for doing building in the future, and we have to make the maximum of the space for organizing different activities. So the idea of using the concrete was also very useful in order to guarantee just the last of the building. Also, it's a very, very, very cheap building for the maintenance. Yes, only in the auditorium is the air conditioned because the rest of the time the building is very fresh during the building and very warm during the summer and very warm during the winter. This is the access to these volumes which contains the auditoriums. So the access is through the back of these pieces that is made also with very, very cheap. So we use there is in the city factory that produce these wood panels that we use the same wood panels. I designed the seats, yes, specifically for this building because I have designed some one previous that were more expensive, but in order to save money, I designed something very, very cheap. I like to design all the furniture and even the handles, the lights for my buildings. It's something that is another interesting activity, by the way. You have here a fantastic industrial design school. There's a kind of very good and success exit for the architect. In fact, I have, during this crisis, I have been living for the royalties of my design. So it's interesting. So this is the you can see this one. And we use this wonderful ceramic. The ceramic is a very cheap ceramic. In fact, initially we have thought the idea of using wood. But after following the wars, I decided that the wood will be very useful in terms of the maintenance, and especially just here because the contrast of the temperature. And then they decided to use this ceramic that is the same ceramic that has been used in the Mediterranean. It's very expensive. After the ceramic is 25 euros. I discovered, yes, we look for an artisan that could produce the same ceramic. So it's the same ceramic that you can see in Sicily, or you can see in Greece, or you can see in the Mediterranean for the couples, and this is the light that we use. Okay. And this is the building. And now I'm going to show you two I don't know, let me know when you are. Two museums. First museum, the two museums are in historical centers, okay? This is the capital of the Basque Country, probably you know very well. The Vitoria is the capital of the Basque Country. Here you can see how clear is the historical city, this almond that define very well the historical city. And this almond has in the top some Renaissance palace. And the almond is going down in a radial system just and towards where was situated just the walls. It's a very gothic scheme that you can read also here in Milan. So it's very. And then as a result of demolishing, of knocking down some buildings, we have to make just the archaeological museum of the Basque Country. So the most important question of this building is the social question, the social concerns about architecture. So we won the competition, but after winning the competition, the government, this area, when we built this competition, was occupied by basically just for the group, political group, terrorist group that support ETA, ETA, probably you know very well. That has been so criminal and that has made my country suffer so much. Okay, this socially was a lot of immigrants and just the most radical elements living here. All the buildings were very dust. All the buildings were completely painted. So, and at the end, the government was very concerned about making the center this building, and they proposed me just moving outside. I decided that we should do it here. Not because I think that architecture is going to save the society, this would be stupid, but architecture can contribute, yes, in order to improve, of course, the social context, why not? So I think that it's possible to use, and we have a lot of examples about it. So I decided to do this building, yes. The building it contains a quite ambitious programmatic requirements. We were speaking about a program about 8,000 square meters, which include, of course, areas for stockaging the archaeological pieces, yes, laboratories, yes, areas for classification, yes, administrative areas, and of course the exhibition areas. So this is the L. We have to use this area because this building was demolished. The street that we have here, very narrow, is a street that is 5 meters higher than this other one. This part of the street go down in a very quite abrupt slope. This is a building that wasn't quite interesting, palace that with a kind of restoration, in my opinion, not very interesting, and that of course that include and that contain another little museum of playing cards. In Spain, there is a company that was produced since the 17th century cards. And they have the mission of this company. So, and then we decided to make an L-shaped building. There are two important reflections about the building. The first one has to do with the urban context. So we decided to make this L-shape for the building for many reasons. The first one was because we wanted to create an open space. It's a courtyard, obviously, but an open space just for the entry that could provide, yes, with a kind of significance to the museum. We're speaking about the museum, it's not the house. How you get in the building is extraordinarily important. So I have a very good master that is Rafael Moneo that usually he say, if you saw the entry and the staircases in a building, it's very difficult that you commit mistakes of the building. So that is very important. So how you make the access, no? Nowadays there is a lot of architecture that you open the door and you are inside. So the process is very important. How you get in, how you arrive, how you cross the building, how you are getting the building. So it's one of the most important moments of architecture. Pay attention about all the classical and baroque architecture. It's based on the sequence of how you arrive and get in the building. In the city, the public space has to do with this. So it's very important. No, it's just only a point. Because no one nowadays speaks about this. People speak about, I don't know, stupid images, but that is important. So I don't know what I was speaking. Okay, this is the entry, and also it provides with a kind of recognition just to this building, no? That is a mission. And also, which is much more important, is that it provides to me the possibility of playing with two different scales when we are speaking about the historical site. One is the conceptual idea, and the second one is that we have not to forget that we are working with very narrow and with a kind of grid, medieval grid, made with narrow and very long houses, with very little corniche, with very little elements. That has to be taken into account. And then with this strategy, which provide to me is with the possibility of using here a quite Gothic shape, very narrow, very long, that of course hide just these buildings, but could establish a relationship, formal relationship. This is the courtyard with the entry, yes, with the rest of the buildings. Here we could establish a relation with the corniche. At the same time, we establish a relationship between this palace corniche and this other one. We create, yes, here a temporary exhibition area which has an independent access to the building. So it provides with this kind of elements that has to be taken into account also when we are relating and we are working in the historical sites. So this is the courier. In this part of the building, we house all the administrative areas. The second idea has to do which is an archaeological mission. Archaeological mission, for me, is something completely different than these big missions. The most important in archaeological mission is the relationship, yes, personal and intimate relationship in between the spectators and the object. So how you establish this relationship, quite intimated, is very important. So the idea of darkness, on how I get in the darkness of the history, how I discover a quite darkness space, is very important. But at the same time, there is another question that is important, is the idea of the time, which is the most important material when we are speaking about archaeology. It's not the copper, it's not the wood, it's not the stone. It's the time. It's the time which transform the city, any elements in archaeology, in something that is in archaeology. So how we can represent the time? It's very difficult. Probably representing architectonical the times, because it's something that is quite personal. But if we use the light, perhaps it's possible. So we define these big boxes that inside are completely dark, you will see, that are crossed with these light volumes, quite dramatic, and we define these boxes just with very thick facades, which contains, with 3 meters, which contains here all the vitrines, and here just the staircase, which allows us just to arrive to the different levels. So the idea of the bronze box, a bronze coffer, is real. We define something very very thick, very intensive, that is crossed with the light. And this is the result. Of course, we use this the bronze. I always like to use the natural materials, or yes, I prefer to speak of historical materials or traditional materials. I speak about atemporal materials. So it's true that we have today resins, we have to do a glass fiber, I don't know. But for me, I'm not very interested in this material because are materials without soul. I prefer to speak about these traditional materials because they are still completely young. These are the kind of material that can establish with you a dialogue, telling to the architect, please, I'm completely open to your action. Try to interact with me. Try to create with me. Try to use me in a different way. But the metal, the copper, the wood, the stone are not traditional, are just simply atemporal, which are fantastic. And allows us precisely to read the transformation of the time. Because this bronze, each day that I go to visit the building, is completely different. It's changing. Exactly this, the same, this wood that is, I don't remember the name, okay. Is, okay. And then all the vitrines are just in this thickness, yes, here. And of course, part of these vitrines are these big windows that simply just point of views, because some of these building, these two windows are looking at the old cathedral, the other one is looking at the palace, because the most important archaeological visit is the city itself. So, it's explained. I think that we don't require more explanations. This is the inside space made with this black stone. You can see here the staircases that are creating one of the very thick side of the of these boxes, from where you can see just the courtyard of the access, how you can see how this is for understanding all the facade is contains the house, the vitrines. Also, it's very important because you have an access. Usually, these kind of museums are quite complicated from the mechanical systems reasons. Yes, because each piece requires a temperature that is completely different, a humidity that is completely different. It's not the same, the ceramic, than the wood, than the, and then the unbelievable amounts of tubes that are arriving to each of these vitrines is unbelievable. So with this idea, everything is quite simple, because you have a meter by 3 meter height with tubes that are, and you can manipulate, you can organize, you can control each of these vitrine. But the museum appears something very familiar, very as if you were in your living room. So this was an idea, transmitting that this is something familiar, very intimate. Just in the underground, there is a library, and the two, another three underground level are all the storage area for around 3,000 square meters, just for the different pieces that are coming from the archaeological sites. Okay, and the second museum is a quite similar position and completely different position. So we are speaking about the museum. It's a building that we have finished recently after 5 years of work. It's a very special museum which contains the four collection, painting collection of Spain. The first one, as you know, is the Prado. The second one is the Thyssen-Bornemisza. The third one is the Beaux-Arts Museum in Sevilla. And the fourth one is this one in Oviedo, just because the, this museum received the legacy of one of the most important families of Spain that has been collecting architecture through the centuries. And we're speaking about this site. This is the one of the most important old cathedrals of Spain, which is the Cathedral of Oviedo. This is the most centrical square, and you can read here again the medieval architecture of the city. Okay, in this area, this is the area, this city that is very well known. You know that this city is the capital of Asturias in the north. The light here is exactly the contrary than in Mediterranean. It's a kind of light that I suffer of, I enjoy, because I like this light also in the north of Spain. And in this area, and I will try to explain just now, we have to do this very complicated building from many different points of view. So here, this is the original state of the museum. The museum is constituted by this Renaissance building. It's a fantastic Renaissance palace that is now full with the collection, and this other house that is undoubtedly the most important house of this area, but it's a house that at the moment, so, but it's not very, I mean, where it's not possible to exhibit and displaying just a picture. It's, in fact, is used only for little pieces. Of course, these Renaissance buildings, during the 60s, there was an extension, a terrible and very ugly extension of this building, which hide all of this facade that is very important, and which house now the conservation areas. Okay, so the government bought all of this part of this square, all of this area, and you can see how this building house this has this wonderful garden. Okay, and then they opened a competition for making an extension, which should contain basically exhibition areas, with a very important temporary exhibition areas, and with the new storage areas. You know that this collection is one of the most important, and with a very special security problems. So, when we started to think about we started to study carefully this space, these houses, we discovered, of course, that were extremely narrow houses. The majority of them has been abandoned, and the slabs and the beams were demolished, so it was not possible, yes, to use all of this area for making the extension of the museum, for one reason, because it was not available, yes, for displaying big pictures, so it was very difficult. And I decided a decision that always is very difficult, which is demolish. I decided to demolish all of this area and to create, because we have to respect this building, and to demolish the new extension of the existing and all of these buildings. And I started to think about the project. Just outside the cathedral, I convinced just the archaeologists and the historians that, but at the same time, I will return just to this photography, to the first one to provide, but I have to recognize that I was absolutely frightened, because of course, what is happening inside was nothing, was destroyed and were very narrow, has no interest. But this part of facade defined the historical street during the last 300 years or 400 years. So you can imagine, if we return to here, this is the, pay attention, I have to create a new facade with this extension. So for me, it was really very difficult, yes, to assume that I have to knock down the building and to create this facade. And also what happened is that this facade were very interesting. And how it is possible to do a building keeping the facade is quite stupid, in my opinion. So I have to leave the facades as facades and making a new building completely different with new facades inside. And then if I have to do a new facade, what is happening? Because I have two facades. And then what becomes very important is the space that is between the historical facade and the new facade. But if I decided to new, this is the most important space, I have to put there just the staircases, the communication of the new building, as a kind of continuation of the street. So at the end, if I have two facades, I can have three facades. Exists a big space in between this street and what is happening inside. Now, okay, you can see this is the historical facade that is preserved as if it has been bombed, no with windows, anything, just only the mineral facade. The new facade that is this one, that in fact is not a facade, is a limit which contains all the mechanical systems, that are in the underground, yes, go up through this very thick facade that is 1 meter. So I didn't provide it with the kind of composition importance, because the most important was the historical. Here, in between these two facades, are the entries, you will see just now. And then we enter here, and these are the staircases of all the museum here. So, and this is really the inside facade. So people that is looking at the picture here, they see the street through one facade, the staircases, and one new facade, and the historical facade. So there are three layers. And then what happened is that this is the street, this is the entry, and this is the staircase that is conceived as a kind of continuation of the street. So then we avoid this eternal problem of leaving the facade and just putting a building touching the facade. Doesn't exist. Exists just a wider street. And this is the project. So this is one of the reasons that organize or create the project. The second one is that the most efficient elements of these two pre-existing buildings is just the courtyard. This is a courtyard that organized very well this Renaissance plan, and there are another courtyard here that provide with a kind of certain dignity to this building that is not. So I decided to create another courtyard to use the same strategy, organization strategy, that has been used historically and works very well. But of course in a different way that I will explain now. And this is the area that is finished now. We are going to continue with this new building that is completely detached of the pre-existing building. So this three-height space, free here, three-height storage space, completely free, that finishes just with this access you get here, and then you can read completely the facade of the Renaissance building just from inside. So this is we could read as a kind of continuation of this street and dividing the two buildings. So this is the project. I don't want to explain. Also, we found some ruins here. Some ruins that is very important, ruins that demonstrate, because everyone in Spain thought that this that Oviedo was coming from the was set in the 9th century. So, and we discovered some fountains which demonstrate that it's coming from the Roman time. So from the two centuries before Christ. So, and was an important discovery, because everything, all the historiography of the city changed. And then we decided to keep. So this provides with a kind of complexity, more complexity to this area, because this could be read, of course, this fountain there is a continuation under the street. So all of this area acquired a kind of intensity that has to be solved in a very simple way. So these are the different plans, and this is the result. Here you can see the new building that is behind this facade, a new building that is made with a special glass. It's a glass that is exactly the same. It's a glass that you can see here. I have seen this morning in the school, in the professor offices, that is with the triangles, glass, and you put behind again a mirror. Then what happened is, as happened in Oviedo, in Avila, it becomes a kind of mineral and reflects everything. So it was an idea for reflecting the color of the old facade. The old facade is painted with a quite original color, and then the color that is behind here is reflecting here, especially during the night, creating this kind of mutual reference. No? And people can see exactly what is happening just with the archaeological elements that are behind this window. This is the entry that in the space that is in between the old facade and this new glass, and very thick, which contains the structure. You can see here, which contains the structure, everything. And this is the staircase that is part of this facade, even in order to underline the independence of the museum, and just with the other elements that are completely different, they don't touch in order to define. There is just 20 centimeters here that I was extremely concerned about to keep this distance in order to, and from here, just inside the building, you can read this from this facade, the old facade and the street, and then the richness of these layers are providing with, this is properly the limit of the museum, and from here you can read them. And the other space is this big courtyard that is deeper, go just to underground level, and which provide just for the temporary exhibitions. This is the courtyard, but what happened is that again, one side of the courtyard is extremely thick in order to house the staircases that is leading from the entry just to this lower level. And then we get in light through this very thick wall, creating a quite sacred space. But the most important is that this space allows us to have, at first glance, the view about all the museum. You can go to anywhere because you know exactly, here is the collection, this other collection, the Sorollas, the Picassos, and then you can move because you have, at first glance, all the view on the museum. This is the model of this space, particularly here is where we cut this double space
that has this very extraordinary height, space just for the staircases that leads precisely. So we use one thing that is interesting. We use the white, but all these thick windows are enveloped with aluminium. This is very nice because sometimes the aluminium, with the reflection of the light, is quite similar to the white, but they change and they produce a richness and they underline how these windows here is changing during the day. So this is a staircase. This is the light that cross, and then you arrive to this. Of course, this space has also the skylight. And this is the museum that has been explained. The skylights are very important. And just only the three facades are touching each to other when you arrive to the square, and then from here you have a wonderful view on the cathedral. So this is a kind of poetical, for telling the three are only one when you arrive to the cathedral, that is the most important piece. So, I mean, as you can imagine, it's very difficult to understand everything just without visiting the buildings. So one of the things that you have to do to the students, a good recommendation is, don't read. Okay, you can read. You can read magazines. You have to read magazines. Read, not look. That is different. Eh? It's not the same. Look at that. Read. Look is just only a glance. Read means think, reflections, study, the plans, the section. So it's very different. You have to read magazines, books, of course. But the most important is that you visit the sites, as used to be done just by the former architect, that they take just 6 months. It's not cheap, it's not expensive. It's very cheap now. 6 months for visiting just Europe or just United States, just only looking at buildings, visiting buildings. It's the best way. So the lecture is very nice, but it's not possible to transmit the, okay. I think that I'm going to finish with this one. I have three more, but everyone is tired, and I will finish with this one. That is the last one. It's the hugest project that I'm doing, and it's unfinished. It will finish just in May, but it's very, very huge. It's a building of 80,000 square meters and 500 meters long. And this is this is Palma de Mallorca. It's also in the Mediterranean. I thought that I will never build yes in the Mediterranean more, but I was very lucky. This was a very interesting competition. For me, it was very interesting because I was young, 7-8 years ago, but we were competing with Roger, with Rafa Boneo, Eduardo Souto, Juan Navarro, Dominic Pegol, and we won the competition. But this making just a big Congress hall with the hotel, with everything. No, it's a very, very huge building. So you can see here, this is the Palma de Mallorca Bay. Here you can read the cathedral, and this is the new building. From here to here, there are 500 meters, 480 more exactly. This is the motorway that arrived from the airport, but you can see how close we are to the bay, to the sea. This is a very important bay walk, of thousands of people just walking continuously from here just to the other part of the city. So it's quite central area where was going to be done this Congress Palace with a hotel, with exhibition areas. I repeat, 800 with a level of parking. So in our project, the most important thing, when I remember that we make the explanation to the jury, I never spoke about a building. I spoke about the wall, and I spoke about a line or just a treasure in the city. Here you can read the Renaissance buildings, the Renaissance walls, the rest, and here you can see the cathedral. Sorry, here, in the cathedral. So we're speaking, pay attention, the size of the cathedral,
that is enormous, and pay attention to the size of this building.
We are not speaking about the building. We're speaking about a piece of the city. We have not to understand the buildings in objectual terms. We have to understand the buildings in terms that we are making a city that is a building. So, and exactly is what I did. We will return to this. So you can read here the size, the walls, and the this. And then we decided to create, yes, a ground floor completely open. In fact, this is the ground floor, but in general it's divided. This is the Congress Hall, this is exhibition area, this is the hotel. But our idea was creating a continuity, very clear, in between the walk that is coming in the city, in this part of the city, in the bay, at least joining with the rest of the neighborhoods, and just creating this continuity in the same that people can get in here in a quite free way, creating these intermediate spaces that are covered, but at the same time are outside. This is a special entry. This is another entry that is covered but is open. What happened here, creating these intermediate spaces that are particularly interesting for providing with shadow. The second thing that was very important is that the treatment of the facade, again, is happening the same than in Teulada. This orientation, that is the sea, is the orientation towards the sea is the southwest. That is terrible. Again, we have the same problem. And again, appear the very thick facade. How to make a facade that is controlling the sun and the light. And if we have a very thick facade, I like these thick facades where happen many different things, when happen intermediate spaces, where it is possible to house the staircases, as in this case, as made, I don't know, Alvar Aalto in the Helsinki Congress Palace and many other architects. So I don't like very much these buildings that is a very narrow facade. And here we are outside, here we are inside. I always have suspected that we are losing an opportunity for doing architecture. So in this case, it's a fantastic thick facade, which allows us to put here the mechanical staircases which link all the levels without getting in the building. So the mechanical systems appear as a kind of continuity of this walk. And people can come here, can go up to the restaurants that are in the top level. So it's very easy to understand this facade, and then we organize exhibition areas. And in the same way, there are another thick facade that is towards the north, that is in a quite different composition, which contains the servant spaces, offices, I don't know, restrooms, that are necessary, yes, for providing with services to these big infrastructures. We have this, I'm not going to show all the building because it's not finished, and I prefer just to make the presentation of the building when it's finished, but I'm going to show you some of the facade. So, an anecdote. This building was designed 9 years ago, and I was in Harvard teaching, and one of the students came to me for telling, I want to introduce you a new material. A new material that is produced by my father in the south of Canada. My father is general of the Canadian Army, and they have another colleagues, they are military, and they prepare this material. And this material is aluminium foam. This aluminium foam was used for covering, enveloping the tanks, okay? Because then it's much lighter than the steel, and it absorbed the impact much better. Okay. And I decided to, we are going to cut this, and the aluminium was produced in big volumes, no, in big, and I decided to cut and to create just plants, yeah, to create just boards. This aluminium I used in Pamplona first time, in a little bar, and after that I used all the aluminium for all this massive facade with 30,000 square meters. But the problem is that the project has been stopped by the economical crisis many times. It's the same aluminium that is used in the foundation just here. In the Prada Foundation. So, but was not discovered by REN. we discover and we introduce to them this material. That, of course, he liked immediately. It's very Kulhasanian material, but it's very natural at the same time. It's a quite similar to stone. But I think, sincerely, that here is used much better, because I'm quite expert in this material. Okay, this is the construction. Yes, in order to provide the students about the complexity of the construction, these are the auditoriums. You can see the auditoriums and the construction of the facade, this facade, that is made with this grid of steel profiles that after that are covered just with this. But in fact, the first time that we use here the aluminium was 5 years ago or 6 years ago, and the work was stopped. But it has stamped perfectly, yes, in front of the sea. It's a fantastic material. So this is the exhibition area that is 300 meters long by 40. These are the Congress halls. I don't want to show just color because it's a special wood and the facade is very interesting. This is the image that now we have outside that is quite finished outside. But you can read here this material. On contrary, this north facade is made just with stone, the same stone that you can find in the island, but is used just as in the fish, yes, and the skin of the fish, yes, in order to look for shadow, yes, because these elements provide with a kind of shadow, because otherwise will be very plain, the facade. This is the entry, yes, to the auditoriums. At the end is the museum, and here you can see the final aspect. All of these glass boxes contains just the mechanical system, the mechanical staircases that are leading just from the ground floor just to the area where are just the restaurants, all the congress halls are here. Here are auditoriums, exhibition, the hotel. So it's very complicated programmatic building, but it's very simple, the way of solving. And has to do a lot with the Cathedral of Palma de Mallorca. You have in there, in the Palma de Mallorca Cathedral, is characterized, yes, that this vertical composition that we try to look here. So, okay, I'm not going to finish the lecture because it's very late. This is Spanish Pavilion that has been public. Everyone knows him, no? I think that it's better just to leave the students for asking questions, no? Everyone knows this building. Len, I think that is not necessary to explain. So I wanted to summarize just to finish the lecture with these words that I started with. Is to the students. Try to be optimist. So are a lot of difficulties for practicing architecture. But it's because we are accustomed to think that architecture is just only doing these buildings. Nothing to do. The reality has changed completely. So you have to discover your own world for practicing architecture in very little and very small programs. Perhaps you receive a commission for making a very little apartment could be the most important work of architecture in the world, because it's your world. It's a fantastic opportunity. Perhaps there are more architecture than in one of these huge buildings. It's very important. Secondly, try to be critic. Nowadays, architecture is very easy. Everyone believes that it's a question of bi-dimensional question. Facade, image, renders, nothing to do with this. It's much more important the section, the plan, the site plan, the relationship with the site, physically, but culturally, economically, how we use the possibilities for the materialization of the building, social concerns, all of this, how to do the most with the less. So all of these questions that has been so important in architecture, and we have the history of architecture for learning. Read the history, not only look images, but try to enjoy architecture. You have the right for committing mistakes. More, you have to commit mistakes because if you have not committed mistakes means that you are not assuming risk. So, thank you very much.